Our first guest today is Ed Yong. He is a writer for The Atlantic. He also has a great book out about the microbes within us called I Contain Multitudes. He has been a leader in science communication for years, and specifically recently, he's written some of the most important public pieces on this pandemic. And so we're so happy to have you. Welcome.
Hi, thanks for having me. The pandemic is obviously probably the biggest story of our generation. It's an epoch-defining event that has uprooted so much of our lives, and I think requires the best possible journalism to rise to meet this occasion. For me, that involves a few different things. Much of my training as a science journalist, and specifically as a science journalist at The Atlantic, has been about trying to not just tell people what is happening, but help them to make sense of what is happening. That's true from even like a silly animal behavior study to like a thing about a global catastrophe. It's not just about writing stuff down, but about offering some element of analysis that will help people make sense of what is going on. And that's so important right now because it's so hard to make sense of what's going on. Right? We're all drowning in information and misinformation. I also think that, and I've been talking about this a lot in interviews about pandemic coverage, that I think it is very easy for those of us who have backgrounds in the sciences and traditional sciences to look at this from a purely, I'm not sure the best way of describing it, but like an angle that is more, say, biomedical, right? So you would look at like vaccine technology or, genomic surveillance or like a lot of very hardcore epi, virology, immunology, all these disciplines clearly are important for understanding what is happening. But I think many of us, myself included, have in the past overly focused on that without also bringing into the fold disciplines like anthropology, like sociology, like a lot of what the humanities have to offer and how they influence how all of that biomedical stuff plays out in practice. One of the big learning curves for me and the big goals for me during this event has been to try and bring in a much broader interdisciplinary look at what's happening. There has always been misinformation. I've been doing this for 15 years. There's always misinformation about everything. Even before I was writing, I was in a cancer charity doing spokesperson work, the whole field is rife with misinformation. Now, why it happens, I think, firstly, like, there's a lot of it in this pandemic because everything is happening at a much greater pace, right? So the two things you always need to remember when you're talking about the pandemic are scope and pace. So it's a huge crisis that affects all aspects of our lives. So there's a vast amount of things that you need to know and therefore could get wrong. And it's all happening at a very quick pace. So things are moving quickly. And as a result of that, so those two factors, scope and pace, combined with the newness of it, the fact that we actually don't have solid answers for a lot of the things people want to know, all of these combine to create what scholars have called, so I think Kate Starbird at UW talks about this really well, about this vortex of fear and anxiety. So people want answers. There are no answers. They are afraid. They are uncertain. That drives them to this greater like information seeking mode where they want to fill in that gap of fear and anxiety by looking for more information. But of course, that information doesn't exist. So they keep on looking. Like you all probably have experienced this before. Like if you ever doom scroll through Twitter, that's that cycle, like, happening in front of you. And that creates openings for misinformation, right? So that makes people vulnerable to grifters. Now, why there's so much misinformation? So many reasons, right? So let's look at the scientific enterprise. Academia rewards people for publishing papers in high impact journals. And that creates incentives that draw people towards sloppy research, small, underpowered research, bigging up their claims beyond what they can justify, you know, p-hacking, all of these kinds of processes. And those incentives are even greater in pandemic time because scope and pace, right? This is a lot going on. And where previously, like, if you hyped your findings up, you might get on the national news. Now, if you hype your findings up, you have, like, international attention on you. So that's part of it. Then the incentives to the media are also, you know, weird and perverse. A lot of working journalists have ridiculous deadlines and don't have the time to do actual journalism. So a lot of very small incremental stuff gets covered uncritically and then goes viral. And then once the stuff gets covered and gets unleashed into the internet, we know that algorithms that run things like Twitter and Facebook and YouTube are almost, they've been called radicalization engines because they are designed to maintain engagement and attention. And that means that they almost like automatically prioritize extreme content, even when it is polarizing, dangerous, or inaccurate. So the whole ecosystem, right, from the production of knowledge from academia to the conveyance of that knowledge by journalists to the transmission of that knowledge through online spaces, means that misinformation cascades more. And again, like, there is an evidence base for this. Like, we know that misinformation on, say, things like Twitter travels at a faster speed and reaches more people than accurate information. You can either give up, I'm not sure that's tenable, but what I'm trying to think about is ways of addressing misinformation that almost like mentally vaccinates people against further misinformation. So it's not just saying this is wrong, it's also trying to explain to people, here is why there is confusion, here is how people who say this is wrong are thinking about it and why they are convinced. Here is what it would take to change their minds about whether something is wrong or right. Here is like the evidence it would take to change their minds and the time frame and steps it would take to acquire that evidence. Right? So it's not just saying what you've heard is wrong. It's like it's trying to ground people so that they can analyze not just what they have heard before, but everything that they're going to hear in the near-term future. Because one thing that is predictable about the COVID-19 pandemic is like the sources of misinformation are not new, right? The types of misinformation are not new. Some of the particulars are strange and bizarre, but like in the main, a lot of these things are predictable. You can try and be a little bit more proactive, like trying to head stuff off the gate and actually also show people like how the process of science works. So it doesn't just become a series of like naysaying things that feel intuitive. Look, I think that I don't think of science in this way. I don't think of findings. And I don't think of it as a series of discoveries. I prefer to think of it as a set of concepts and a set of attitudes. And I will tell you the ones that have made the most impact to me over the years. The first, and this is crucial for any communication and especially for science journalism, is that science is inherently imperfect. It is not a set of finding out truths and discoveries accumulated over time. It is a process where you gradually reduce uncertainty in a very erratic and meandering way, and people will often get it wrong. So if you don't already know, please internalize this idea that a lot of the published literature is wrong or bad, and it is your job to work out how to tell that from the stuff that's actually good. I am always so shocked at the number of people in university and postgrad levels who assume that because something has been peer-reviewed, it must be correct. So not true. So be critical and be watchful. The second is that science is absolutely inextricable from the rest of society. So I've already talked about how the biomedical aspects of the work I used to do did not give due credence to sociology and anthropology and other social, social sciences. That we can go much further with that. So everything we learn about in the sciences has a social element, has a political element to it. You cannot only do the science while also ignoring how the rest of society interprets that science. And equally, you cannot look at science and the way that science is done and who gets to do that science in the first place without grappling with issues of misogyny and racism and transphobia and homophobia and all of the rest, right? There is an inherent social justice element to science that you cannot ignore, and you do so at your peril. And if you choose to ignore it, fine, you're going to really harm a lot of colleagues and people further down the line just through passive neglect, if not through like active dismissal.